So if we make the front page article the recent tax mistakes,
get this done final as soon as we can so that we can...
Sir, I've got something really strange going on. You have to take a look at this.
Yeah, okay.
Sir, 10 minutes ago I noticed a worm moving through our network, hundreds and hundreds of machines using an MSRPC exploit with multiple evasion techniques. Antivirus does not detect this, but luckily we do.
Which site is that?
This is site one.
Chris, what do you think?
I think we need to respond immediately.
Okay. Jax, declare this as an incident. Chris, let's get the management team together as soon as we can.
This is NATO's Computer Incident Response Capability Technical Centre, the heart of the Alliance's fight against cybercrime.
We believe that it is exploiting the recent .lnk vulnerability. It actually tries to propagate itself using network shares and the removable drives.
NATO's member nations report five or six important cyber incidents every day. This time, it's only an exercise. Following any attack, the centre's director, Ian West, calls together experts from the departments concerned. Everyone knows what they have to do. Things can get out of hand in a matter of seconds.
NATO's Computer Incident Response Capability provides cyber defence services for all NATO sites, whether they're static headquarters or deployed in our operations or exercises. And we do this by trying, wherever possible, to prevent incidents and attacks from happening. But where we can't prevent them, we need the ability to be able to detect them and respond quickly to them. And when those attacks are successful, which unfortunately sometimes they are, we need to be able to recover the systems so that we can get back to our normal operations as soon as possible.
Cyber attacks are growing in number and in scale, from individuals seeking notoriety to gangs trying to cripple states. Recently, hacktivists from the group Anonymous called on their members to target NATO. Before that, the WikiLeaks affair made headlines worldwide, exposing, among other things, diplomatic cables allegedly stolen by a disgruntled soldier. In seconds, computers across several borders can come under fire. European nations and institutions have also been hit. NATO's priorities now are to help allies prevent attacks, to provide services like education and training, and to lend a hand in times of crisis.
Cyber attacks are increasing every day against NATO systems, against important systems in our member states. And NATO, therefore, has to go beyond purely providing protection to its own systems, which was a little bit where we were before the attacks in 2007 against Estonia, to being able to offer cyber services, cyber protection to our member states so that we can help them to prevent attacks, detect attacks, and if attacks take place, quickly respond to limit the damage.
The attacks on NATO member Estonia brought its ministries, parliament, banks and media to a grinding halt. They were a turning point in the way aggression via computers is perceived. NATO set up a cyber defence centre of excellence in the capital Tallinn, dedicated to research, development and the training of experts, as well as to sharing information and lessons learned. But the Stuxnet virus, which appeared in 2010 and seriously set back Iran's nuclear program, made the leap from the virtual to the real world. Critical infrastructure like power stations, transport networks, and hospitals have never seemed so vulnerable. Adrian Velciu is in charge of security at Transelectrica, the operator of Romania's electrical network. He's permanently in the front line, defending a critical piece of national infrastructure. Because, as Adrian says, security is always too much until it's not enough.
This place is the most important key asset of the critical infrastructure for electricity. From this point, all the commands are given for a smooth operation of the whole electricity sector in Romania and also in the southern part of Europe. Due to the importance of this facility, we have here a high level of security, not only for physical security, but also for cyber security. If something goes wrong here, the whole country will be affected. A lot of people and a lot of activities of the state will be put in a bad position. The risk is very high to have a blackout, not only in Romania, but also for the neighboring countries. because of the interconnections in the European grid. We rely on very well-trained people, trained also in security, but also on cybersecurity and the fight against terrorism. We were trained also in some seminars with NATO.
Transelectrica's IT department is managed by Teletrans, a telecommunications operator that controls, among other things, the network's secured computer system, known as EMS SCADA.
After the attack by the Stuxnet virus, we understood for the first time that the SCADA system is not invulnerable to attack, as we thought before. After that, we carried out some audits. At this very moment, we're conducting an audit to check all the security points in the EMS SCADA system to be sure there are no problems. It is impossible to get into the system by accident.
Back at NATO, the experts are trying to counter the attack as the exercise unfolds.
We've noticed some suspicious events coming from your site. Can you please check your EPO server and to verify as well whether your systems are receiving patches correctly or whether they're not patched?
The goal is to detect weaknesses and supply patches, but this is not a job NATO can do alone. Without the help of private industry, companies specialized in protecting computers and systems, its defense network would be compromised.
Hi, Arthur. Actually, the custom detection signatures are available from the vendor. Could you please publish them on the portal immediately? Yes, thank you.
One company which provides software and expertise to the Allies is Symantec. The head of its government affairs in Europe department, Ilias Chantsos, is only too aware of the size of the problem. Over the last 8 years, the number of new viruses appearing annually has risen from around 25,000 to 286 million.
The more our daily life is dependent on critical infrastructure and on ICT to run it, like the distribution of energy or the telecommunications or even transport systems, the more we're dependent on computers to run all these facilities, the more by the moment these systems are being attacked, it becomes a threat to our national security and to our economy and to the way we live our daily life.
At the moment, it's the cyber criminals operating in networks who have the advantage. To stand a chance, NATO and its partners must pool their resources.
Industry, government, critical infrastructure operators need to find ways to cooperate better and exchange information better in order to also better understand what the threat is and how they can collectively defend themselves.
One of NATO's key partners is the European Union. In Brussels, the EU's efforts to prevent and fight cybercrime is being coordinated by Home Affairs Commissioner Cecilia Malmström. Clearly, there's no sense in doubling up.
But sometimes you don't know where the attack comes from, and sometimes it can affect the critical infrastructure. That's critical for us, but also for NATO. And to build up competences, exercises, analysis, intelligence, preparedness, awareness raising, it seems a bit unnecessary to do that in parallel, but we can really join forces because only the criminals will benefit from us doing parallel things.
Sometimes it's too late for prevention. At NATO, the decision's been taken to dispatch a team of rapid response experts to help on the ground. The team has grown out of NATO's cyber defense policy, which was revised by defense ministers in June 2011. Efforts now focus on preventing threats and building resilience. The United States has even urged its allies to consider that a major cyber attack on any member should be deemed an attack on all and warrant a collective response, including the use of military force.
I think is a powerful sort of political signal that we do not consider that cyber attacks are somehow the acceptable form of conflict in a way that launching a nuclear weapon against somebody is the unacceptable form of conflict. It's an attack. An attack via electrons is just as unacceptable as an attack by tanks or aircraft.
At Transelectrica, Adrian Velciu's workday has come to an end and he's heading home. Of course, his family computer is shielded from viruses. Like his nation's security authorities, Adrian is particularly conscious of the need to protect and back up his sensitive data. Romania must remain vigilant and work closely with its international partners and industry to to ensure that the people of Bucharest can sleep easy